Hey there, welcome back. In this lesson, we're going to cover electrical systems for your van. We'll go over all of the different options for powering your life on the road, and then we'll take a deep dive into solar power since that offers the most flexibility for van life. We'll talk about all aspects of solar for the van, including solar panels, inverters, batteries, wiring, and more, and I'll share my setup with you as an example. So let's get started. Your electrical system is one of the main ingredients to ensuring a quality living experience on the road. Do you want to be off-grid without ever having to plug in? Will you be a weekender or full-time traveler? What sort of appliances will you run and how often? You might want to power a fridge, a fan, lights, a water pump, a heater, a laptop, or a blender, or all of the above. These are just some of the questions to ask yourself when determining how much power you want and ultimately how big of a battery bank you'll need. There isn't a one-size-fits-all approach to van life, but together we're going to explore the foundational pieces necessary to determine your priorities to help you plan for your ideal electrical system. The three primary ways of getting power are solar power, a generator, and plugging into shore power. Solar power is a great option if you plan to be off the grid often and want to be able to sustain your day-to-day without needing to fuel up a generator or to plug in. Opting for a solar power system is a more eco-friendly option, but it does have a heftier initial investment. To have a complete solar setup, you'll need solar panels, batteries, a charge controller, and an optional but recommended automatic charging relay. We'll get more into that later in the lesson. Powering with a generator is a tried and true method for road travelers and was the go-to prior to the rise of solar power. Generators do have their pros and cons. They're favored because of their reliability, no matter the weather or the time of day. Plus, you can move them around wherever you go, creating power even when you don't have access to the grid. Generators are also ideal if you plan to run an AC unit, electrical heater, or a microwave. These things aren't easily powered with a solar setup due to their high wattage requirements. One caveat with a generator is you need to keep gas stored, so that's something to consider when planning your build. The generator and fuel tanks are heavy and they take up a fair amount of room, so you'll need to have a dedicated space for these. A storage box on the outside of your van, like those made by Lithium, is one option. Another major downside of a generator is the noise factor. Generators can be loud, impacting your ability to enjoy the sounds of nature. Plus, many paid campgrounds have a sound ordinance or noise pollution policy, restricting their use during certain hours of the day. Shore power is a viable option if you plan to stay in full-service campgrounds with plug-ins. If that's the case, this is the perfect option and will allow you to use power as you normally do in your brick-and-mortar house. Even if you don't plan on staying in campgrounds all of the time, being able to plug in to top off your batteries is a smart option, especially for those winter months. When the days are short and the sun isn't out very long, being able to plug in your batteries if you're running low will help prevent them from getting damaged while allowing you to still function in the van. My shore power plug is located up underneath the hood, and while we haven't had to use it out of necessity, it does give me peace of mind being there in case I were to ever have an issue with my solar setup. A final option I'll recommend is to connect your house batteries to your vehicle's alternator, which allows you to charge your batteries while you are driving. I don't recommend relying on this as the only way to charge your batteries, but it is a great backup, especially during the winter months. We'll talk about this option a little more later on. Since solar power offers the most flexibility to live off the grid, that's where we're going to focus most of our time in this lesson. In case you're not already familiar, the way a solar power system works is that the solar panels capture the sun's energy and convert it into electricity, which is then used to either directly power something, or more commonly, that energy is collected in a battery that can then be used to run power from. If you're using a battery, which you will if you're planning on having a solar setup in your van, you will also need an inverter to convert the DC power in the battery to usable AC power for your appliances. In the rest of this lesson, we'll be covering all of these elements that make up a solar power system, including your solar panels, inverters, batteries, wiring, charge controllers, and more, starting with solar panels. When shopping for solar panels, you'll encounter two main types: monocrystalline solar panels, which I'll call mono, and polycrystalline solar panels, also known as poly. Both serve as the same function in capturing energy from the sun and turning it into electricity, but there are some differences between the two that are important to be aware of when shopping for your panels. Mono panels are generally more efficient and have a slimmer design, but they tend to be more expensive. Poly panels are typically less expensive, but they're also a little less efficient. With limited roof space, it's important to consider the most efficient panel setup that will support your power needs. A well-built solar panel from a reputable company is rated to last over 25 years, so it's a good idea to explore both of these options before making the investment. Ultimately, the differences between the two types are only slight. Once you narrow down your needs and preferences, the most important thing is to buy panels from a good company with quality products. If you've been following my blog for a while, you know that I've had XAMPP solar panels on both of my vans. XAMPP's panels are made of high-efficiency monocrystalline solar cells and are manufactured right here in the U.S. They have a comprehensive quality control process, ensuring that each panel is built to the highest standards. I've been extremely happy with their products and wouldn't hesitate to recommend them. I've shared detailed write-ups on my blog and YouTube channel about the solar setups in both of my vans that you'll find links to in the resources section. Now let's move on to inverters. As I mentioned earlier, an inverter takes the DC power from your battery bank and converts it into usable AC power that comes out of your 110 outlets, just like in a regular house. If you have anything that needs to be plugged in, or a microwave or an induction stove, you'll need an inverter. The two primary types of inverters are pure sine wave and modified sine wave. Each one transfers the flow of energy a little bit differently. Efficiency and cost are the biggest differences between the two. Pure sine inverters are more efficient and will operate all appliances within their wattage range. They're more expensive, but will provide a steady flow of energy. Modified sine inverters are a more economical choice, but will use significantly more energy and might not support certain appliances, like a refrigerator, microwave, or induction stove. Some newer devices won't operate well on a modified sine inverter either, so it's important to research the exact appliances you plan to use and what the manufacturer recommends. If price isn't an issue, pure sine is the way to go because all equipment sold on the market today is designed for pure sine waves. But this isn't necessary for everyone. It all depends on what you'll be powering. Next, you'll need to determine how powerful of an inverter you need to get by looking at wattage requirements for each device you want to power. The wattage represents the total amount the inverter can handle at any given time. Things like an induction stove, power tools, a microwave, or a blender all have a high draw, so they'll require an inverter that has a high wattage rating. If you'll only be charging one computer at a time and an occasional appliance, you can look for something in the 600 to 1200 watt range. If you plan to run an induction stove or a microwave while charging multiple appliances at the same time, you'll need a high watt inverter around 2000 watts or so. This is what I have in this van. We use our induction stove at least once a day, and a 2000 watt inverter has been able to handle whatever load we put on it. It's important to be aware of the demands of your appliances and devices so that your own needs are met and your equipment can be used properly. Otherwise, by overloading your system, you risk damaging your batteries. Once you've got a good idea of how much power you'll be drawing, you can determine how big of a battery bank you'll need. In my experience, it's better to overestimate your needs than to underestimate, so make a liberal estimate when you're planning your battery bank. Battery capacity is measured in amp hours, which is a measurement of how much electricity the battery can store. Choosing a properly sized battery bank is vital and depends on how much power your devices will draw and the wattage of your solar panels. There are two main types of batteries to consider, AGM and lithium. AGM batteries are heavy-duty and durable. They're built to handle consistent vibrations and changing temperatures. They're slightly less expensive than lithium batteries, especially since lithium batteries are newer on the market. The downside is that AGM batteries can only use 50% of their total capacity, so once they're below 50%, it's time to recharge. That means if the total capacity of your battery bank is, let's say, 400 amp hours, you really only have 200 amp hours of usable power. Frequent depletion below 50% significantly decreases the lifetime of AGM batteries, so it's important to monitor them to ensure they're getting the charge they need. You can do this with a voltage meter. When your AGM batteries are full, your voltage meter should read around 12.8 volts. As you consume battery power, this number drops towards 12.0 volts. If it gets down below 12, you need to charge your batteries as soon as possible, as anything lower will start to degrade the battery. Another thing to note that if necessary, AGM batteries can be mounted outside if you're looking to save space. However, if you do have space inside and you spend a lot of time in harsh climates, I recommend keeping your batteries inside the van. AGM batteries are sealed, so they do not off-gas, so it is safe to keep them inside and it will protect this big investment from the elements. Lithium batteries are considerably more expensive up front, but they're also more efficient. They're long-lasting, but they don't handle cold temperatures very well and they must be kept inside the van. So depending on your plans and your budget, these are important factors to consider. they can use 80% of their total capacity, so you have more amp hours to use before needing to recharge. Comparing this with the previous example we used, if you have lithium batteries with a capacity of 400 amp hours, then you actually have 320 usable amp hours compared to only 200 with the AGM batteries. This means you can get away with a smaller capacity and lighter weight battery bank because you get more from each battery. The downside of lithium, apart from the upfront price, is they require greater temperature control. If the temperature gets below freezing and you try to charge them, the batteries can be damaged. Of course, if you're traveling in your van and you have water in the lines, you want to avoid freezing temperatures regardless, but if you spend a lot of time in wintry climates, this is something to consider when choosing batteries for your van. If AGM batteries are properly used and well taken care of, they should last a long time. But if they're not and you need to replace them multiple times, it can be costly and might add up to the initial cost of going with lithium to begin with. Even with the two types of batteries, each brand will quote different lifespan and number of charge cycles. Ultimately, it comes down to your budget and climate demands. If you plan to travel or live in a van during the winter, you'll need to size up your battery bank to ensure sufficient power throughout sunless days. Plus, running a heater 24/7 regularly to prevent freezing pipes consumes a decent amount of power. Whichever you choose, the key is to find a reliable company with a good warranty policy. Batteries that come highly recommended are Battleborn for lithium and North Star for AGM. Now I'll briefly touch on wiring. First, the most important thing when it comes to installing an electrical system is your safety. I can't stress this enough. Whether you're DIYing a solar electrical system yourself or you're hiring someone else to do it, safety and efficiency are essential. Improper wiring can be dangerous and put you at risk of electrocution or an electrical fire. Because of this, it's important to understand the basics of a wiring diagram. Essentially, there will be positive and negative wires running from the solar panels to the charge controller, wires from the charge controller to the battery bank, and wires from the fuse block to each battery, as well as wires from the battery bank to the inverter. See, it can get confusing very fast. This is only a very basic explanation to help you understand how everything is connected, but we're going to link to some very helpful resources down below for more information. It's important to keep wires neat and tidy and avoid excess wiring running every which way in your van. Keeping a clean setup and choosing the right wire type and size will help you prevent unnecessary loosening of wires due to the frequent motion and shaking in the van. If you're hiring somebody to build your van, this is an area they should have a lot of knowledge and expertise in. Again, it's all about safety, and poor electrical install has potential to not only give you trouble, which would be super frustrating, but it can also be dangerous. For those of you who are DIYing, we've included links to some of our favorite resources below this video to help you better understand what sort of wiring you'll need depending on your load. Okay, now let's move on to the charge controller. While the solar panels convert sunlight into electricity, that electricity voltage and current isn't suitable for the batteries. So that's where the charge controller comes in. The charge controller converts the voltage and current from the solar panels and deposits it into a usable charge for your battery. A charge controller also protects your batteries from overcharging, improving their longevity. There are two types of solar charge controllers. The first is called PWM, or pulse width modulation. These are cheaper, more compact, less efficient, and require your solar panels to be wired in parallel, which is a little more complex. Again, I'm going to refer you to some additional resources below this video if you want more details. The other type of solar charge controller is called MPPT, or maximum power point tracking. An MPPT charge controller harnesses the maximum energy coming into your panels so your batteries get maximum input. These controllers are more expensive, larger, and also give you more flexibility with the way you can wire your solar panels. Controller we have in this van is the ZAMP 30 amp 5-stage PWM charge controller. I've linked to some additional info on this controller in the resources section. It's installed in the corner of one of my cabinets and provides a simple way to monitor the solar power coming into my batteries. It's worked like a charm and only costs $130. Now I'm going to touch on automatic charge relays, a small but important piece of the equation. An automatic charging relay is a small device that attaches to the vehicle's alternator. It is an intelligent, inexpensive piece of equipment that allows an alternator to charge your house batteries while you're driving. Having one of these means that if you're on the road for a few hours, your batteries will be fully charged when you arrive at your campsite. Since your vehicle's starter batteries are a priority, this device charges the starter battery first and then switches over to top off the house batteries. It's fairly easy to install and is a great backup when it's cloudy out. Before we wrap up this lesson, I want to share a little bit about my personal experience with the two different setups I've had in my vans. My first van had 180 watts of solar and a 375 amp hour AGM battery bank. What I found with this system was that on longer days in the summer, it was adequate. But as soon as the days got shorter, I had a long stretch of cloudy days, I really had to watch my consumption. I found myself plugging in more or using the van's alternator to top off my batteries. And for that reason, I decided to size everything up in this second van. In my second van, I have 440 watts of ZAMP solar panels on the roof and a 660 amp hour AGM battery bank. My batteries are also hooked up to my van's alternator, so they charge while I'm driving. After 2 years, this system is still working great. To give you an idea of what we charge in this van, we have two electric bikes, my computer, a bunch of camera equipment, two cell phones, a dustbuster, a blender, an induction stove, and a few other random electronics that we frequently charge. I've never had to plug in by necessity or had to be stressed out that my batteries were dangerously low. The system has worked great, and I'm happy I overestimated because I never have to think about having enough power. The downside of my setup is the battery bank is very heavy due to its size, and it was also quite expensive. I chose AGM because the lithium technology was and is still evolving, and I decided to go with the tried and tested system. In the future, I would consider lithium as a way to save space and weight, but I'd need to take extra precautions with temperature control since we use our van on ski trips. For more information on my setup, I've included links to a blog post and two of my YouTube videos down below in the notes.